اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا يا ربنا من فضلك علما وإخلاصا وحلما. Imam al-Nawawi narrates with his sanad to Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, where he says, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول. So the way that we'll try to do this is we'll see if we can create a momentum. And so if I'm going to read the hadith in Arabic for right now, soon I'll start having you all read the Arabic as well. If I'm going to read the hadith in Arabic, we've read the chain. We've read the setup of the Sahabi who's narrating. So when you read, just be ready to start with the actual statement of the hadith, whether it's beginning with what the Sahabi is telling a story about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, or the statement of the Messenger itself. But that setup of the chain, we'll consider that that was taken care of in the Arabic, and pretty much everybody knows what was said in the Arabic, inshallah. سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إن الله عز وجل قال إذا ابتليت عبدي بحبيبتيه فصبر عودته منهما الجنة. نعم يريد عينيه. Please, تفضل.
I heard the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم say, Allah عز وجل says, when I afflict my servant by means of his two beloved things, and he exercises patience, I repay him with paradise in lieu of them.
Very good. So, Habibatehi, his two beloveds, his two eyes. So this is a shout out to all of our blind brothers and sisters. Mashallah, there's an organization that was founded for blind Muslims to learn knowledge of deen in Scotland. Sheikh Abdulaziz Frederick was a big driver behind that, and a very close friend of his who was blind, among quite a number of other physical problems, challenges that he was dealing with in life. He eventually died very young. Allah yarhamu. Sayyid, so there's the patience, huh, with the bala of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وعن عطاء ابن أبي رباح قال قال لابن عباس رضي الله عنهما ألا أريك امرأة من أهل الجنة فقلت بلى قال هذه المرأة السوداء أتت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت إني أسرع وَإِنِّي أَتَكَشَّفُ. So she has two things that she's complaining of. فَدْعُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لِي. So ask Allah for on my behalf. قَالْ إِنْ شِئْتِ سَبَرْتِ وَلَكِ الْجَنَّةِ وَإِنْ شِئْتِ دَعَوْتُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَنْ يُعَافِيكِ. نعم. فقالت أَصْبِرُ فقالت إني أتكشف فادع الله أن لا أتكشف فدعا لها. متفق عليه. تفضل.
Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه asked me, shall I show you a woman from the inhabitants of paradise? I replied, indeed. He said, this black woman who came to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and said, I am overtaken by epileptic seizures, as a result of which my body is exposed.
Or at the very least, seizures. Right. So she says, I get seizures. Epilepsy is not implied. Fadal.
Supplicate to Allah Azza wa Jal in my favor. He said, if you exercise patience, you will be rewarded with paradise. But if you wish, I will supplicate to Allah Azza wa Jal to cure you. She replied, I will exercise patience. She then added, however, my body gets exposed, So supplicate to Allah that my body does not get exposed. So he supplicated for her.
SubhanAllah. Ya Rabbi. Your mission if you choose to accept it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives people a bala. Right? If people look around and said, Wallahi, I've got no bala going on. Right? If that's true, then that's probably, you should be thankful. Definitely. We should never wish. لا تتمنى لقاء العدو. Don't wish to meet the enemy. But if you find yourself in a situation where you have to meet the enemy, right, then know that paradise is under the shadow of swords. Okay? So we don't wish for bala, but if we find that there's no bala in our lives, no tribulation, no trial, no test, something might be wrong. Because everybody should have some trial, everyone should have some bala. Now you might have a person who's like this woman and saying, Wallahi, everything's good, right? You have those people, mashallah. But Allah gives people a trial, a test. And you'll see several, a number of situations where people come to the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam with their tests, and he says, well, we could, push reset, or look for a different, spin the wheel again and come up with a different combination, right? Or you could just take the test that you've been given, and the reward for being patient with that is the Jannah, right? And you see the reaction of the different Sahaba. What happened on the day of Uhud, right? One of the Sahaba, his eye came out, and he said, I really care what the ladies think about me, and so that would be hard. And the Prophet had just offered him Jannah in return. And he said, no, I want my eye back, right? And so the Prophet ﷺ put his eye back, and it became his best and most precise eye. And one of the Sahaba said, and his best looking eye too after that. But SubhanAllah, we need to, those who are responsible for a Muslim community need to help to create an environment that is conducive to yaqeen and rewards yaqeen, so that people who are going through tests can comport themselves with that yaqeen always, and that is at the level of leadership and the responsibility of leadership. When you're on your own, you just deal with what Allah sends your way, and Allah might send you a crummy community, right? Where you're being plagued by doubts left and right. But the reason why the first rule of leadership in Islam is run from it is because of the responsibility for it. One of the first, maybe the third rule of leadership in Islam is know that you should never find yourself in a situation where you are contributing, or we are contributing, to other people doubting the promise of Allah and His Messenger. That is a heavy, heavy weight. Regular people can say what they want, do what they want. They can throw their ego all over the masjid and make a big mess. But people who are in leadership, right, they can't do that. Allah help us. Allah help this woman. And Allah help us to understand and allow us to have the yaqeen, to be confident that this current set of tribulations is not because Allah hates me or because I'm a lost cause, but because this is my tribulation. And if I'm patient and I get through it with a little bit of serenity, right, inshallah, it will be good in the end, and Allah will be pleased with my performance. Right? The next hadith, number 12. Tayyib. So I made some notes for you all. Sayyid, عن أبي عبد الرحمن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال كأني أنظر إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحكي نبيا من الأنبياء صلوات الله وسلامه عليهم ضربه قومه فأدموه وهو يمسح الدم عن وجهه يقول اللهم اغفر لقومي فإنهم لا يعلمون متفق عليه. How many people are learning Arabic here? Actively learning Arabic here? Okay. So I might provide some thoughts. Tafaddal.
It is as if I can picture the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam relating the story of one of the prophets whose people beat him until blood flowed from his body. While wiping the blood from his face, he said, O Allah, forgive my people, for they do not know.
Okay. So, كَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ. Here, Ibn Mas'ud is speaking of the strength of his memorization, of his memory. Right? I recall this situation with such clarity, it's as if I see the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And in the Arabic, he says yahki, right? What does yahki mean in Arabic? To speak, right? Yaqulu, yahki, hikayatan, right? Storytelling, the storyteller, right? They didn't have television back in the day, so they had what? Who knows? The name of the person they had would sit in the, I guess, the coffee shop or the tea shop, you know, in the neighborhood. And tell stories. Does anybody know the name of that person? Huh?
Storyteller.
Hakawati.
Huh?
Hakawati.
The Hakawati. Right, he'd sit and tell stories. So yahki, but here it doesn't mean that. Okay? Here it is an alliteration, I believe, is the correct term. It's as if I see the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and he is illustrating the image of one of the previous prophets, right? He is cutting the profile of one of the previous prophets, meaning living and being something that we heard was what the earlier prophets had done. In this situation, that earlier prophet is not who we think it would be in the Judeo-Christian world, but the prophet Noah. And Siddiqi, Ibn Allan al-Bakri, Siddiqi says that whenever you see a mention of one of the previous prophets, very often it is the Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. So our narrator is Ibn Mas'ud, Tayyib, Abdullah. Al-Hudali was his tribe, and he was one of the mustada'afin in Mecca. He was one of the first, some say the sixth person to convert to Islam. Huh? And he's the one who was tending to the sheep outside of Mecca when Abu Bakr and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam passed by, right, and asked him to give them some milk. And it was actually a test, would he stay loyal to his master and say that, you know, these aren't my sheep, to be given the produce away. And the sheep were the sheep of Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'ayt. Huh? He actually went to Habasha, right? And then he came back and then went to Medina. He was there at Badr and the Bay'at Ridwan in every major event with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he was one of the people obviously who prayed toward the two qiblas, both qiblas. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam always honored him, always drew him close, and he never kept him beyond what's called the hajib. The hajib is the person who watches the door and only lets people in, right, who have permission, and he never kept him beyond ma hajabahu, right? And that is a thing. very much a thing. So the people who watch the door, the people who control entry, there are certain people who they know not to sort of question before going in. He was known as the Sahibu Sirri Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the keeper of the Prophet's secret. When he traveled, he would carry the Prophet's siwak and his shoes and the water for making wudu. He was one of the Ashara al-Mubashirin bil-Jannah. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam said about the maqam of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Raditu li ummati ma radiya laha ibn ummi abdin. I'm content with my ummah so long as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, right, ibn ummi abdin, is content with this ummah. Right? So if he's happy with y'all, then I'm happy with y'all. SubhanAllah. وَمَا سَخَطُ لَهَا مَا سَخَطَ لَهَا لَنُوْ أُمِّي عَبْدٍ. And I'm not angry with them, right, so long as Ibn Umm Abd is not angry with them. It said that he was the most resembling of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in his way of doing things and his samt. What is samt? So, have you heard this word before? Samtuhu. Samt. Samt. Samt is demeanor and the way you carry yourself. Okay? And there is a samt for inheritors of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam because he had a samt. And there is a proper samt for students of knowledge. Right? There are aspects of studying this knowledge that will affect the degree to which you learn, the degree to which you master, right? So whatever we think about how cool it is to be casual, we can't lose sight of the fact that there is an issue of sunt. And the student of knowledge is not a scholar, right? Contrary to current conditions, right? The student of knowledge is not a scholar, but the student of knowledge is also not one of the public. So we say that the lay person has no madhab. Obviously, many lay people think they have a madhab, and they do. If they want to have one, they can have one, and they want to be consistent about keeping track of a particular school of Islamic practice, then that's a good thing, but we don't hold them accountable for it. But the person who considers themselves a student of Islamic learning, they don't have that same excuse, right? They have to adhere to consistency in practice. You know, Allah help us and teach us, right? But they are expected to adhere to that consistency. So once a person embarks upon talab al-ilm intentionally, right, with intent and purpose, they're no longer one of the public. They're no longer one of the public. Right? Na'am. Waliya qada'u Kufa, right? He was placed as qadi over Kufa during Umar's khilafat, and the beginning of Uthman's khilafat. He eventually came back to Medina and died there. Some say that he died and was buried in Kufa. I'll bet you there's two graves for Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, just like I think Bilal has three, mashallah. One for the summer and one for the winter. No. So he died 32 years after Hijrah, and he was 60 plus years of age, radiallahu anhu, wa salla alayhi Zubayr laylan. They buried him at night. And Zubair is the one who prayed over him. Huh? And according to the understanding that he was buried in Baqiyah. Why? Because Zubair was the person who was made his brother when they arrived, the Sahaba arrived in Medina. Now, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And there's a lot more about him. He's one of the Abadila. He's one of the ulama of the Sahaba. Right? All of the Sahaba are like stars. All of the Sahaba, we say, are good narrators. All of the Sahaba right, have a special standing, but not all of them are the muftis of the Sahaba, right? Some of them are considered the ulama of the Sahaba, right? And Aisha is one of them as well. Tayyib. When we read in the Dars of Traditional Knowledge, if the student is doing the reading, the way it works, many of you know this, is that the person doing the teaching or the commentary will step in, so the person reading knows that at any moment they might pause, right, for comments. And then when it's time to continue, in Syria, the sheikhs will say, Fadlal or Tafadlal, right? So it's Tafadlal, and if you want to drop the T and make it easy, you can say Fadlal, and that means continue. In Morocco, they say Zid from Ziyada, right? Continue. Tayyib. He said, كأني أنظر إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحكي نبيا. We discussed that. ضربه قومه فأدموه. Right? That is the situation that was making Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam look like one of the prophets of previous revelations. Because there were other prophets who were being beaten by their people, right? And were shedding blood. Okay? ضربه قوم, and they caused his blood to flow. And he would wipe the blood from his face, saying, Allah, forgive my people, for they know not what they do. And of course, in the Western culture, we attribute the same statement to Isa ibn Maryam. عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا وَعَلَيْهِ أَفْضَلُ الصَّلَاةُ وَأَتَمُ التَّسْلِيمُ. The interesting thing here is that there's an assumption on the part of the Muslims that that is the Prophet Nuh, alayhi salam. Interesting. So when we watch Sayyidina Isa doing the same thing, huh? كَأَنَّهُ يَحْكِي نَبِيًّا مِنَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. Right? And that is another demonstration of the fraternity of the Prophets. وَفِي هَذِهِ الْجُمْلَ أَنْوَاعٌ. Right? And we have a number of lessons, specifically three. Ibn Alam wants to say the first is that he's wiping the blood or trying to catch the blood. Why? So it doesn't hit the ground. And he's worried that if the blood of their prophet touches the ground, right, which is not where the blood of a prophet belongs, that might end up in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bringing down his wrath on those people. And he doesn't want that to happen to the people who are causing his bloodshed. So, we also have to think about our attitude towards non-Muslims, right? We have to be honest about the teachings of Islam and not go to extremes, right? People get scared. When you're scared or lazy, it's easy to go to extremes, right? So we're not encouraging people, right, to go to extremes and re-engineer Islam in a way that it wasn't meant to be. But at the same time, we understand that there are, you know, parts of the world that have a very sad and abusive situation. There are historical reasons why that's the case. You know, we know, of course, that there's no excuse for harming other people, no matter who they are, no matter what their faith is, and what have you. But we have people who are motivated by anger and frustration or desperation. It's not fun to be, you know, from a part of the world where everybody's fighting over that part of the world, and the people who are responsible to make your population safe, to make your population be able to provide, to allow the population or enable the population to be able to provide for their families, when they're not standing up for their duty, right? A civilization that has no patriots, or a society or a nation state that has no patriots anymore, right? In fact, the rulers are not looking out for the well-being of their own people. They're looking out for the well-being of corporations or, you know, other, or the powers that allow them to stay in place and not be overthrown and so on. So people feel like they need to take the well-being of their own people into their own hands. Other people feel incredibly emasculated, right? And that's a very common feeling in some societies, which isn't fair. But without good guidance and without an understanding that you just can't take your anger out on everyone, people feel like enough humiliation, right? Enough being kicked around. We are going to figure out different ways to let people have a taste of how angry we are. And religion is a very, very useful tool or accelerant for the fire of anger. And we can see how it gets used even in this country. And we can see even where people are moved to violence by their own conceptions of Christianity, even in this past election season. So we also recognize that very often a lot of these knuckleheads are being manipulated by people with political purposes. For example, in Nigeria, when you have elections, all of a sudden we're trying to cut people's hands off and stone people and do all of these things that none of which are an objective or a priority of the Deen of Islam, but is red meat for the electorate, you know. So a lot of that stuff is going on. But the essence of Islam, look at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. These people are in the midst of drawing his blood, spilling his own personal blood, and he's trying to save them from any further punishment. SubhanAllah. And, you know, we say, you know, these aren't the people who pushed you out of your homes and so on. These are the people who pushed him out of his home. These are the people who are currently trying to kill him. These are the people that he has permission to fight, but he doesn't want it to go too far. Right? The second lesson, أَنْهُ قَابَلَ جَهْلَهُمْ بِفَضْلِهِ, that he met their ignorance with his virtue, and he prayed that they be forgiven for this crime, right? So one of the interesting questions that's going to be asked about this hadith by the hadith commentators is that he said, Allah forgive my people. Well, khalas. Once he asked Allah to forgive them, then there's no more sin that they could ever do. They're forgiven and good to go. They say, well, in this instance, it's for this particular crime, right? So the phrase is general and all-encompassing, but if we were to understand it in that sense, it would lead us into, right, some contradiction in our application of theology later on, in that anyone who fought against the Muslims at the Battle of Uhud, right, is now, what, Ashra Mubashirin, right? 300, right? Thalathumiyat Mubashirin? No, right? They said for this applies to this particular crime. And the third, أَنَّهُ اَعْتَذَرَ عَنْ سُوءِ فِعْلِهِمْ بِعَدَمِ عِلْمِهِمْ, right? He sought pardon for their bad behavior because of their lack of knowledge. SubhanAllah. And then the commentator says that anyone who travels the path trying to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be aware that he must or she must adorn themselves with the very thing that they are studying or teaching. And there is a story that a soldier once beat one of the arifin, right? An arif, raise your hand if you don't know what to, if you're not familiar with the term arif, right? What is an arif? Right?
Gnostic. Gnostic.
A Gnostic, good word, right? Excellent English word. We have to define it ourselves, of course, because Gnostic and Gnosticism has a different connotation, but it's okay to appropriate words, even like saint, right? There are words that are useful. but we have to provide our own definition for them. So an arif is someone who knows Allah intimately, right? An arif has to be one of the ulama who has a special God consciousness, meaning they have taqwa. They have knowledge of theology, as well as experiential knowledge of theology, right? Taqullah wa yu'allimukum Allah, right? Fear Allah and Allah will teach you. Okay, so there is a very special experiential knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So a soldier is walking around town beating people who don't seem like they're in line with what the soldier is supposed to be enforcing. It's what happens when you put the military in a policing situation for civilians. He ends up beating one of the arifin. He didn't recognize who this person was, and they told him, you know, you just hit this person. He's you know, a special person in society. And so he returns to the person and is apologizing. And the arif says to him, right, I already let you go from that, right? I've already forgiven you and left you innocent of what happens. And I prayed for you in place of where you hit me. And he said, well, why did you do that? I didn't even apologize yet. And he said, why? Because you are the cause of getting me into Jannah, so I'm not going to be the cause of getting you into the hellfire. Right? SubhanAllah. That's shukr, right? Appreciation. The next hadith. عن أبي سعيد الخدري وأبي هريرة. Both of them are narrating this hadith. رضي الله عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما يصيب المسلم من نصب ولا وصب ولا هم ولا حزن ولا أذى ولا غم حتى الشوكة يشاكه إلا كثر الله بها من خطاياه متفق عليه فضل.
No fatigue, illness, worry, grief, injury or anxiety afflicts a Muslim, even to the extent of a thorn pricking him, without Allah Azza wa Jalla expiating his sin by means of it.
Inshallah. Nasab is fatigue, wasab is illness or chronic pain. Wasab. Huh? And the reason here is this. Oftentimes, when people get tired, they're not on their best game, right? They get fatigued and worn out at the end of the day. That's not the time to be in a situation where someone's trying your patience, because you're probably going to lose your patience at that point. And wasab, right, the choice of this particular word and the idea of chronic pain, ongoing pain and discomfort, is because people who go through this often end up getting frustrated, losing hope, becoming cynical, right? And so on and so forth. So it's really a big deal. And potentially, this is where people sometimes become angry with the qada and qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And know that if you are tried with this and you can comport yourself with patience, and resolve, that there is a great reward here, because you've resisted, you've accepted the qada and qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and resisted becoming angry with your lot in life. Allahumma, we ask Allah to relieve our pain and to relieve our suffering, the inside pain and the outside pain, right? Where it hurts on the outside and it hurts on the inside. And we ask Allah to give us the strength and resolve to deal with what we have to deal with, right? But sometimes people lose hope, okay? وَلَعِيَابُ بِاللَّهِ. But there is a great reward in that. In the Hikam of Ibn Atta, he said that tribulations are the 8 days of those who seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's specifically talking about sickness, right? When the times go bad for you, right? When things don't go well, right? We can think of all different instances where things don't go well, but if you realize that what Ibn Atta is specifically talking about this is sickness, right? When you get sick. So we could look at it as, I'm sick, I'm weak, this doesn't feel good, I don't like this, 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 and that. And but if we can somehow get our aqal, right, to help us along and step back and look at this and realize that, well, it's like chutes and ladders, right? I could move ahead real fast on the board I can just like handle this well, you know. And when you're not able to do all the things that are on your agenda, that are on your list of things that have to get to done, because you're so sick and you feel like I can't perform the way everyone needs me to perform right now, and I have deadlines and other stuff I have to meet, that makes it even harder to just be real serene with the sickness, right? Because you can't really take a day off. But Allah help us, you know, to stand up and deal with what we got to deal with. Tell you. MashaAllah. So, it's your knowledge of the reward that prevents you from falling into the trap of getting frustrated and losing your temper with the what is effectively the qada and qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look, right, as you operate as a human being, you got three things going on. You have your physical body, right, and that plays an important role. You have your soul, and you have your intellect, okay? And then you have a whole lot of synonyms going on to confuse you, right? But know that you're really working with a physical body, you're working with a soul, and you're working with an aqal, okay? Throw you a curveball since we have students of knowledge. The aqal is actually one of the things that your soul does, right? So it's an ability of the soul, but there are three distinct modes of operation for the human being. So our, okay, body, mind, and soul, but then we also have the ego. That's what I wanted to get to. So we're working with the ego, we're working with the soul, and we're working with the intellect, right? And those are three different modes of operating as a human being. So the ego is obviously trying to get you to do everything that is fun, lathive, lazy, doesn't take any effort, and probably is so much fun that you shouldn't be doing it, okay? It's going after pleasure, instant gratification, and so on and so forth. The soul, obviously, is interested in your hereafter, and it's operating at a quite another dimension. The aql is or is not able to manage the difference between the two. And what you want is you want to be in a place where your soul is stronger than your ego. Many of us are not in the place we need to be in yet. Okay, so there's a lot of struggle going back and forth. So if you can get your aql to work on behalf of the soul, right, and do things to outsmart the ego and give the soul a little bit of a head start, or, you know, a little bit of affirmative action, right, and create a situation where your soul can actually get strong, right? That's what can be useful. So sometimes we understand something with the aql, and sometimes just understanding it with the intellect is not enough. You may be going through some type of difficulty in your life at a particular moment, and the problem is that you know all your answers. You know what to tell yourself, because if someone else came to you and said, oh man, this is happening to me, all this, you already know what to tell them. And you know what to tell you. But it doesn't grip or gain traction yet. Why? Because, you know, the soul isn't strong enough to take that on. So sometimes we can, you know, if we can strengthen at least, you know, the intellect is sometimes an easier thing to strengthen than the soul, because the soul, you know, it's a long game and it requires much more stamina and permanence. The intellect can operate quicker. Sometimes we can use that ability, you know, to get ourselves to a place where the soul gets a chance to get stronger, right? And that's one of the things that's happening here in this hadith. Wala hamun. Sure. Wala hamun. Wala hazan. What is ham?
Worry.
Anxiety. You say anxiety, right? Worry. Being anxious, right? Always question your terminology, right? So we always translate it as anxiety, and you're correct, right? And that's right there in my mind too. But let's always see if we can find a way to link up these things with what we with those things that we actually experience. So anxiety is something that people experience, but the feeling is one of being anxious about a situation, okay? And in such a way that it grips you in a way that brings about fatigue, and fatigue of the soul, and so on. This worrying, right, that grips you. And hazen is what?
Sorry.
What's that?
Sorrow.
Sorrow. Yeah. Right, now bring it home.
Depression.
Depression. Okay, Muslims don't get depressed, right? No. So hazen, right, there is an extreme to hazen, right? And if you put hazen together with the hem, well then you definitely have the depression. So you have two things happening here. This is right up there in Islam, along with chronic pain and fatigue and so on. So yes, being patient with it, but there's something else. Notice that Islam recognizes. The teachings of Islam recognize that this is something that people suffer through. Okay, that people suffer through. And when there is a way for us to relieve the suffering of others, this is what would be included. Okay? Al-Iz ibn Abd al-Salam says in his Qawa'id al-Ahkam that the prophets have been sent and the books have been revealed for no other reason than to procure benefit and prevent harm. We should switch that. Prevent harm and procure benefit. Because? Why? Huh? What?
Priority to prevent harm.
No. Dar al-Mafasid muqaddamun ala jalb al-masalih. He said, what is good? Good is pleasure and happiness and the means to obtain it. What is harm? Harm is pain and hem and gham, right? Which is even more severe. Severe, but psychological. You know, worry, anxiety, and these types of things, and the means, those things that would cause it. So there he's putting it right at the center of Islam itself. We could be a lot more empathetic. We could be a lot more sensitive than we are. We're sensitive about all the stuff that we probably should be more patient about. But we could be a lot more empathetic, a lot more sensitive and nuanced as a community than we are. But of course, that is an issue of tarbiyah and theology, and we don't do very well with that, right? We don't really see any theology in North American Islam, right? Or Western Islam at all. Right? I know that that's a shock, but if you look at what other communities are doing in theology, they're doing some amazing things. We're not doing any of that stuff. Right? But then again, it's an issue of leadership. So when those who are sure they should be in charge come around, maybe we'll get a chance. No. He says about وَلَا هَمٌّ وَلَا حَزَنٌ فَرَّقَ بَيْنُهُمَا بِأَنَّ الْأَوَّلُ لِلْمُسْتَقْبَلِ. He says هَم is for the is about the future, and حَزَن is about the past. Nice. He said that وَقِيَع said, who's وَقِيَع? Anyone who studied with Imam Zayd will know who وَقِيَع is. Anybody in their right mind, anybody on the right track has to know who Waqiyya is.
Imam Malik.
What?
Imam Shafi.
Imam Shafi.
Imam Shafi went to him.
Imam Shafi. And Nisha go to the Waqiyya Suha Hifdi. Right? So he's one of the fuqaha, the muftis of Mecca, along with Khalid ibn Muslim and Zinji. He said that Waqiyya said لم يسمع في الهم أنه كفارة إلا في هذا الحديث. ما شاء الله. Because ultimately, the patience, or the fact that the Muslim is going to ride this out, he's going to say إلا كفر الله بها خطاياه. Except that Allah will give him an expiation. So Waqiyya says, you don't hear that hem can be a cause for expiation except in this narration. وَلَا أَذَن وَلَا غَم هُوَ أَبْلَغُ مِنَ الْحَزَن. So غَم is even more severe than sorrow. So غَم might be your depression. لِأَنَّهُ حَزَنٌ يَشْتَدُّ بِمَنْ قَامَ بِهِ حَتَّى يَصِيرَ بِحَيْثُ يُغْمَى عَلَيْهِ. Interesting diagnostic. He said that gham is a hazan that becomes so severe and critical such that the person suffering through it, it becomes as if they have lost consciousness, right? Lost consciousness, literally lost consciousness, or they just can't see straight anymore, right? And maybe it's as if the person who's going through a particular bout of depression, to everybody else it's a normal day and you do what you do and you function okay, but this person is just having trouble just functioning basically and seeing, you know, up from down and right from left, as if they had lost consciousness. Why? Because they're going through some type of internal trauma that affects their ability to see. And sometimes all you need is for someone to be in contact with someone who can show you that the world is still normal, right? And can we be that someone for people who need it? Not if we allow for the normalization of the abnormal, right? In our communities, we can be empathetic and sympathetic with people's idiosyncrasies, but there's a lot of really, really foul, abusive behavior that goes on in the Muslim community that somehow, for different handful of reasons, we tend to sweep under the rug. And because I don't want to talk about this person's bad behavior or bad faults or shine a light on it because that's not Islamic, I allow them to continue to abuse other members of the community who are not able to defend themselves, nor do they have a defender, right? But alhamdulillah, we're Islamic at the end of the day. And just be patient, brother or sister, with the qada of Allah and the qada, right? Yeah, I'll be patient with the qada and Allah and the qada, right? But that's not for you to be patient with. Every single instance of a crisis or a crime or a tragedy is a test for three people, okay? Three people are being tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here. And no one more or less then the other. First, it's a test for the victim to be patient with their situation and try to maintain the teachings that will please Allah, the conduct that will please Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is, of course, a test for the victimizer, the one who is doing the abuse, obviously. But it's also a test for the bystander, particularly the one who has the wherewithal to do something about it and just stands by and watches it or says, you know, this doesn't have anything to do with me, or I don't want to mess up my relationship with the person who gives the most of the money in the masjid or something like that, or the community. Right? I mean, we have a tyranny going on right now in North America where people are afraid of those who are slinging the most money around the community. Some people give money for their akhir. There is a generation that is disappearing one by one in this country. One of the most impressive exports from the Muslim world to the West are people who really truly believe that if they give this money, it's going to help them. Huh? It will help their family. Kan abuhuma saliha. It will help their akhirah. It will help them sleep at night. Okay? Whatever it is, they believe that it means something. That generation is not being replaced when they're dying. And I've been to cities around the country where people say that after so-and-so died, the community went to their kids. And their kids just shook their head and said, we're not our father, right? And, you know, we'll see you in the Maldives. So that's one. And there are others who use it for power, okay, and influence. They will tell you that this community is afraid of people with money, okay? I don't understand that psychology, but there's probably a lot of stuff that I should try to understand better. And there are people who use that in order to exert influence, power, and control. And I've even seen people who use it to buy friends, inclusion, or tolerance for their bad behavior. And then once they've thrown down those massive funds, they don't make any attempt whatsoever, right, to not to be foul toward the people in the community. And what is lost is the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is lost is the mission of this deen and the healing that it can bring to the world. Ya Rabbi. Hatta tayyib. Right, even to the point of just a thorn that would prick a person. This is the lowest level of pain or suffering that a believer could be patient with and receive some type of kafara from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And notice here, min khatayahu, right? So he said it will be an explanation, an expiation, min his sins or her sins. What is that min doing there? Can you guys tell me?
Pardon?
What?
Pardon.
Right? Does anybody recall what is the designator of min as a particle? Tab'id. Right? So ba'd is some of a whole. Min indicates someness. So what's happening? Your patience with these types of suffering, even the thorn that might prick you, right, so on, will be an expiation from some of his sins. Right? Some, not all. Why?
Because some, like the kubara, the big sins, need like a special expiation.
Repentance. Yeah. Right. So it can't do all, right? Because some of them require the particular repentance, like the major sins. So watch out for min and the role that it plays in a sentence. The modern, the 20th century, some of the 20th century faith movements say about the, wow, all that time has passed already? I'm sorry. Y'all are probably just really upset with me that I didn't cover more territory. We'll get it together. Some of the 20th century faith movements like to say about the Ashaira that, well, they only believe in 13 attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or 7, depending on how they're counting, or 21, right? So how, I mean, is that the sense that you all have from studying Ashari Aqidah, that we only believe in 13, right? So there's a longer explanation of that, but if you notice in the Sanusiyya, which is the most famous text that outlines the attributes that every believer should be intimately familiar with, if they're not familiar with what is realistically more than 99, much more, what is it, somewhere around 120, 130 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but different configurations of 99 have come, right? 13 that everyone should be intimately familiar with, but he said, mimma yajibu, from that, from among that. So it says right there, in the most famous text, from among those things that are necessary, the answer's right there in front of everybody's eyes, but we don't know Arabic anymore. We're not attentive to it. We're not listening. Is that the Iqama too?
Yeah.
We'll close.